So far, we have talked about the vibrations which are classified as free vibrations. They're called free vibrations because the only force that tries to restore the position of a rigid body or a particle back to the equilibrium are the forces that are inherent to the system. So when we talked about the spring mass system, we had a spring, we had a mass, and when this mass was displaced by a certain amount in one of the directions, the spring was stretched, and the spring force in turn was trying to bring the particle back to its equilibrium position. Similarly, for a pendulum problem, you had a rod or a ball of mass m tied to a light string or a light rod, and this was swinging. And in this case also, the force that tried to bring the particle back to the equilibrium position was a component of the gravity, right? Not the tension. So the gravity force acted as the restoring force, the force that tried to bring it back to the equilibrium position. And these kinds of vibrations are called free vibrations. And, these vibrations in reality always die down, right? Because you always have friction, you always have some sort of drag. And as a result, you can set something in motion and it will vibrate for a while, but it will come to a stop. Most of the practical engineering systems are of a nature where there has to be an external forcing function that will cause the vibration to continue. So, for example, in your cell phone, you have a vibration motor, which is powered by a battery, right? And that causes the vibration to continue. Otherwise, the friction is going to bring the vibration to a stop. So, in most of the engineering applications, you'll find that vibratory systems are put in vibration primarily because there is an external excitation. Okay, so external excitation has to be a periodic function. So let's say we have this force F called F0, we'll call this sine omega FT to indicate that this is actually a periodic function where the frequency of this external force is omega F, all right? And F0 is the amplitude, right? So that's the maximum amount of the force that can be applied on this particle. So now this force, of course, because it's periodic, is going to cause this particle to oscillate back and forth. At the same time, you still have the spring, which is going to play a role in bringing the particle back to its equilibrium, but it is not the only force that will cause the vibration to continue. It is this external force applied on this particle that will cause the vibration to continue. So when you have an external excitation, which is a periodic one, how do you do the analysis of that? Before we do that, let's look at this external excitation. So we chose a sine function over here, but we could have picked any smooth piecewise function that was continuous, and that would work as well. In fact, Baptiste Fourier actually showed that any smooth piecewise periodic function can be decomposed into a sequence of sine and cosine functions, infinite number of those. And since sine and cosine functions are primitive in that case, if we can show that we can do the analysis for one of the sine functions, we know we can do it for as many as we want, right? You might have many more with different frequencies rather than just one that is shown over here. Okay, so let's start with our analysis. We will displace it by an amount x. So if you displace it by amount x, what are the forces? We have kx. We still have the external excitation. So sigma f equal to ma. What does that give us? F minus kx equal to mx double dot, right? And f itself is f0 sine omega ft. And I'm choosing omega f to indicate this is the frequency of the forced excitation equal to mx double dot plus kx. So I'm going to bring this on the left hand side and I'll write it as this equal to f0, we divided by m, so that's f0 over m sine omega ft. Okay, so if you look at this particular differential equation, this is your equation of motion, right? This is still second order differential equation, but this is no longer homogeneous, as was the case for the free vibration, because you have a non-zero right hand side. So this is second order non-homogeneous differential equation. So how do we solve a non-homogeneous differential equation? Well, we know something like this has two solutions, one which is called the homogeneous part of the solution, and then one which is called the particular solution, right? Homogeneous part, we already know how to solve for it, right? So for homogeneous part, we have already seen this looks like some xn times sine omega nt plus phi, right? But this is the part, this is the solution that is not of interest to us, because these are transients, right? This is going to die down. The homogeneous part doesn't play a role in causing the vibration to continue. It's this particular solution that is of more interest to us. So what does XP look like? So what we will do is we will assume that XP actually looks like, you know, some magnitude d times sine omega ft, okay? So the particular solution we are assuming has a similar form as the force excitation, okay? And that kind of makes sense because we know the particular solution actually comes about due to the fact that we have this external excitation. So to assume the same frequency for the XP as the external excitation is, you know, not so bad, right? D is something that we don't know, so we'll try to determine that. So if this is a solution for our differential equation, then let's substitute for XP in here and see what we get. So let's differentiate it. So X dot P would be D omega F cosine omega F T. And one more differentiation will give us D omega F squared sine omega F T with a negative sign, right? So let's substitute this in differential equation and we get minus D omega F squared sine omega ft plus k over m x is d sine omega ft. So notice we are just substituting for the particular solution equal to f0 over m sine omega ft. Now you can see that sine omega ft is common to all these terms, so we can get rid of it. Okay, so what do we get? We get d times k over m minus omega f squared equal to f0 over m. Okay, so d becomes f0 over m divided by k over m minus omega f squared, right? So what we're going to do is we're going to actually write in a slightly different form. We already know that omega n squared is equal to k over m, so we'll write this as f0 over m divided by omega n squared minus omega f squared. Notice the difference. This is your circular natural frequency, which is only dependent on the spring constant and the mass, while omega f is the frequency of the external force applied on it, right? Okay, so another thing we'll do is we'll take omega n squared outside and we'll write this as omega f over omega n squared. So we took omega n squared outside, which is equal to k over m, so m cancels, so we get f0 divided by k 1 minus omega f over omega n squared, and that is d. Okay, so d is the amplitude of the particular solution that we needed, right? Omega f is the frequency of the external excitation, which is known to us because we know what the external excitation looks like. F0 is known. Now we have been able to find the d as a function of f0, k, as well as omega f and omega n, right? Now, this is the part which is called the steady state solution. So x sub h is the transient solution because it dies down, that's why it's called transient. And xp is called steady state solution. So because x is composed of x sub h and x sub p, right? Homogeneous part of the solution and the particular part of the solution. So steady solution looks like xp equal to d times sine omega ft, right? So if you were to plot this d, okay, as you can see, the d is dependent on f0, k, omega f, and omega n. If you were to plot d as a function of omega f and omega n, in fact, you know, what we'll do is we'll not plot the d, but what we'll do is we'll create another term called magnification factor. So magnification factor, or in short MF, equal to D over F0 over K. Now, F0 over K, what is F0 over K? F0 over K is actually the displacement in steady state, right? So in the steady state, if let's say the maximum magnitude of the maximum force applied on this is F0, because sine omega FT maximum value is plus 1, then if the spring constant is K, then under the influence of that force F0 in equilibrium, the maximum displacement would be F0 over K, right? Because F0 has to be equal to K times delta static in equilibrium. So delta static is actually equal to F0 over K. So magnification factor over here is basically nothing but the amplitude of the external excitation solution divided by the equilibrium state displacement, right? So d over f0 over k is equal to simply 1 over 1 minus omega f over omega n squared, right? So now if you plot the magnification factor with changing omega f over omega n, what do we get? So omega f over omega n, when it becomes 1, then the quantity in the denominator goes to 0, right? Which means that it's going to shoot to infinity. When omega f over omega n is 0, so we are over here, then this quantity is actually 1. So we're starting somewhere here, and then it shoots up when omega f over omega n is 1, right? It shoots up, it goes to infinity essentially. In theory, of course, it shoots to infinity. In reality, it will never shoot to infinity, of course, because there is always going to be some drag and friction, right? So when omega f over omega n is less than 1, the quantity in the denominator is positive, so we are going up essentially. But as soon as omega f over omega n increases, goes beyond 1, the quantity in the denominator actually becomes negative, which means that then we will approach the infinity from the other side, so that will be negative infinity. And then as this continues to increase, this goes to 0, right? So this is what we get for the graph of magnification factor as omega f over omega n is changing. So what we're looking over here is, this is telling us that we should avoid this region as much as we can, because in this region, when omega f is close to omega n, the condition which is also known as resonance, when the frequency of external excitation is equal to the circular natural frequency of the system, then we get very large amplitude. So there's a large magnification. So when magnification increases, the amplitude of the vibration increases too, and which is something that we want to avoid in most of the cases. However, having said that, in some of the engineering systems, you can use that to your advantage. So there are devices that actually are based on exploiting the resonance phenomena to do something, you know, better. So for example, the respiratory patients, you know, if they have a problem where they cannot clear their sputum, then you can create a device which causes resonance with the air cavity, and hopefully that can, you know, bring the sputum out. So here we have seen that we get this equation of motion when we apply an external forcing function which varies with time. In fact, it's periodic, right? Because this is sine omega ft. We can obtain a similar equation of motion as shown over here if we were to apply this excitation to actually the support. So let's see what happens in that case. So we still have that same spring mass system, okay? But now I'm going to actually have the support where the spring is joined move in a certain pattern. So this is going to be excited by, let's say, x sub s sine omega ft, all right? So instead of applying a forcing function to the M, the particle, you can actually have this support move, okay, back and forth, all right? So when you have a situation like this, we get something similar. So let's draw a free body diagram. Okay, so we'll displace it by amount x from equilibrium, and the forces would be, and I'm only going to show the x direction forces. So this goes by amount x. This point is moving at amount xx sine omega t, which means that the net stretch in the spring would be x minus, net stretch delta would be x minus x sub s sine omega ft, okay? Which means that the force in the spring would be equal to k times this delta, right? So sigma f equal to ma. So we have minus k x minus x sub s sine omega ft equal to m x double dot. So what does that give us? Mx double dot plus kx equal to x sub s times sine omega ft, right? So you can clearly see that this is of the same form as this equation over here, okay? Which means that the solution is also going to be, you know, fairly simple. So instead of excitation applied to the particle, you can apply that same excitation to the support system, and you will get basically a similar differential equation, okay? So this kind of situation arises when you have a particle and it is mounted on something that is unbalanced. The support itself is actually, you know, moving with a periodic function, and you can get something like this in that case.